before I came in here, I was just in the installation of the Comic Con character exhibition. And you know, I just love drawings. You know, it's, you know, I think drawings are all the more. I mean, any of us that get interested in art, you know, in our lives, I mean, drawings are kind of the you know, the gateway, you know, the gateway to that affection. I mean, that's where, I mean, we start making drawings ourselves as children, and even as adults. I mean, who here has a little pad of paper next to their phone when they're talking on the phone? You know, are there, and do any little doodles ever find their way onto that page? I mean, you know, me, I am a draftsman of little stars and arrows. And, you know, I just can't stop myself somehow, you know? And if you generally star things to, you know, to note their importance in a way, but if everything I starred was really, truly important, I mean, then you'd think I'd have no sense of prioritization whatsoever. So anyway, it's just all of our, drawings are just a special, you know, just kind of a special means of expression. And we can, whether we think of them as works of art, whether we think of them as drawings or not, you know, we're still making those marks on pieces of paper, and they mean something in the moment. And that's very true. I mean, that's true of artists as well. When I think of drawings, you know, I think of them in you know, a variety of different ways. I mean, first, when I think of drawings, I automatically go to Leonardo's Vitruvian Man, and I put this up on the screen, not because I've ever seen it in real life, not because it's really one of my favorite drawings. It's just an iconic drawing, and it's a drawing that is about trying. Drawing can be many things. Drawing can be a way of thinking, in a sense. It's like visual thought, in a sense. Or drawings could be, like this Michelangelo, they could be preparatory studies for other things that are yet to come. This is a drawing for that will eventually become a sculpture. Or they are, you know, I put this image of one of Thomas Cole's sketchbooks. I spend a lot of time with these objects, and they're almost like, you know what a palimpsest is? You know, it's a kind of drawing where there are drawings on top of drawings, you know, it's almost like the archaeology of drawings, in a sense. And that's what, when you look at Thomas Cole's sketchbooks, you can barely see it in this, but see, that sketchbook was originally turned the other way, and there's a landscape drawing in here. But now he's come back on top of it, and he's written notes to himself about a trip to London. This is from 1827, as indicated here, but it's also indicated right here, where he's put his name in the book, Thomas Cole, New York, 1827. In 1827, he was in the White Mountains in New Hampshire, for the first time, making drawings, so we know exactly what. I mean, it's easy enough to trace his life and his travels through his sketchbook, and so that's another thing that they are. They can be a means of record keeping. And the wonderful thing, I mean, other Thomas Cole sketchbooks. I mean, at first, early in his career, they were usually fairly elaborate drawings that ultimately led to paintings. But as he became more experienced as an artist, he would make only kind of schematic drawings, very simple sketches, and then he'd write blue as seen from 5 miles away, green as seen from 10 miles away. You know, his visual logic became so refined, he didn't need to draw. He didn't need to draw anymore. He just needed to give himself the cues of things that were already very, very familiar to him. And then drawings, of course, could be finished works of art in their own right. This is a favorite of mine. This is a drawing by an artist named Charles White, who worked in the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s. This is a drawing in the collection of the artists of Chicago. It's called Harvest Talk. And I happened to be in the print study room of the Art Institute of Chicago when a dealer Yeah, a private viewer, more of a picker. Everybody know what a picker is, you know, it's somebody who kind of finds things at auction or in obscure sales and then sells them to, you know, to actual dealers. But this guy decided to bypass the actual dealers and brought it right straight in the front door of the Art Institute of Chicago, which you're not really allowed to do. But he somehow, you know, he got to security. Security called us. We went and got him, said it's okay, brought him in, and we bought it right on the spot. I'd never heard of Charles Black when he brought this drawing in. Turns out he's a fairly significant artist, and I just didn't know him at the time. And it was wonderful. I mean, we were just so taken with, you know, the power of that arm and the way it kind of projects almost right out of the drawing itself. So drawings are completely legitimate works of art in their own right. They don't necessarily have to be a pathway to something else, and that's the case with this particular. And this drawing is large. It's not as large as you're seeing it on the screen, but maybe half the size. Powerful thing. And this little guy was carrying. I mean, he was totally overmatched by the drawing, but it's a fabulous thing. So I came, I mean, I was interested in drawing. I mean, I'm just like all of you. I mean, I made drawings as a child. I was interested in art from the very beginning. Drawings were my way of offering my personal expression. I actually tried to draw things besides stars and arrows. They're not particularly notable, but I did try, like many of you. But then, in 1988, in January of 1988, so 30 years ago, I went to work for the Art Institute of Chicago, and I went to work in this room, which was at that time called the Glore Print Study Room. And that's where the Art Institute of Chicago's collection of 11,000 drawings and 60,000 prints are housed, right here in this very room. So it looks very clean and light and modern, and it's a wonderful room. But you're actually in the old part of the Art Institute of Chicago. You're in the original 1893 building. We look out these lovely north-facing windows, which create this incredible light into the study room. And these are, you know, works that have been brought out for people to view from the vault, from the collection. You can see that they're not framed, these are just in mats, which is the case for most of the works in that collection. And if you could actually see out this window, you'd look right straight up Michigan Avenue in Chicago to the Wrigley Building. And the clock on the Wrigley Building was actually my wristwatch for a number of years. For the longest time, I just wouldn't wear watches. It was total affectation. And when I worked there, this is after they renovated the print study room in sometime maybe 10 years ago, 15 years ago. There would always be a drawing up here and up here. Often it was a Thomas Wesselman nude, big drawing that hung there. But you know, the thing that a lot of people don't know, and this is kind of unique to the big museums, is that museums like the Art Institute of Chicago, the Met, the Museum of Modern Art in New York, LA County, let's say the National Gallery, all of these museums have departments of prints and drawings. Some of them are departments of prints, drawings, and photographs, but one way or another, they all have major collections of graphic art that are held in storage. As I said, the Art Institute has more than 70,000 works that you will almost certainly never see in the galleries, or only see rarely. You know, works on paper only stay on view for a very short time, maybe 12 weeks, and then they go into solander boxes, and they stay in the dark for maybe as much as 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, maybe, depending on the circumstance. But they're not kept from you if you want to see them. any person can call up the Art Institute of Chicago's Department of Prints and Drawings, make a point, they have open hours where you can come in, you make an appointment, and you can sit at one of these tables, and somebody will bring you a solander box full of Albert Durer woodcuts, or Goya etchings, or drawings by artists whose name starts with B, who lived between the 1860 and 1884. Okay, so, I mean, there and all of those collections, because of the Art Institute of Chicago, the Met, etc., I mean, you can see exactly what they have by going to their website and clicking on collections. And every single one of the 250,000 works of art in the collection of the Art Institute of Chicago have been cataloged and are accessible online. So if there's somebody you're interested in, somebody you want to see, something that you'd like to experience, the Winslow Homer watercolors that Martin Ryerson gave the Art Institute of Chicago in 1932. How about those? Wouldn't it be nice to see those? Well, you'll never see them unless you call, make the appointment, go there, sit at a table just like that, and you'll put on a little easel and enjoy them, and then you put them back. It's a marvelous thing. It's a marvelous thing. And people do it. People have got it figured out. Do it all the time. I have called out, we are drawings, the post-impressionist painter that we like so much, you're going to see a We Are Drawing in just a few minutes. I called out We Are Drawings for Harrison Ford. Yes, it's true. Yeah, that's greatness itself. And you know what? I didn't even know I was doing it until, because I called him out before he got there. I didn't know who I was hauling him out for, I was just hauling out, I've even gotten a request to see We Are Drawings, and I walked by Harrison Ford four times before I realized I'm looking at Harrison Ford. I mean, he looked just like these kind of bookish scholars that would come to the print room and look at drawings, And it's like, what that guy looks like? And then somebody said, that is him. So anyway, I got to work at the Art Institute of Chicago because this man hired me. This is Douglas Druid. It was probably, when he retired, he was the director of the Art Institute of Chicago. But when I met him 30 years ago, he was curator of prints and drawings. And he retired in 2015, but he is one of the great scholars of impressionism and 19th century drawings in the world. I mean, he's done the list of shows this man has done is phenomenal. And he, like I said, he hired me ultimately through one of his many subordinates. And for about 2 years, I did exactly what I just described. From 1988, and maybe 88 and 89, I was the equivalent of this man's drawings ballet. I sat in the print room, and when somebody wanted to see something, I would go back into the vault, bring out the solander box, get out the drawings that were the prints that they wanted to see, and they would look at it. And of course, if Douglas, this man right here, this incredibly smart man, to whom I really owe everything, and honestly, the way we do things here at the Dixon, if any of it seems like, what in the world are we doing? Blame it on him. Blame it on him. There's more than 70,000 works in this vault. And if Douglas had someone there, someone he knew who was making an appointment to come and be in the print study room and look at some prints or some drawings, he was so smart and had such a memory that he would inevitably send me back to find something among those 70,000 that he wanted to show to some scholar friend of his. And of course, it would be some completely obscure thing among those 70,000 that if I didn't come back out in a matter of, let's say, 60 seconds, you know, there would be not hell to pay, but there would be a very kind of disapproving tsk, 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 you know. And so, because of that anxiety, you know, I don't know that I saw all 70,000 of them. Certainly, they've acquired a good number of them since 1998 when I left the Art Institute. But I saw a bunch of them. And looking at drawings is just such a healthy thing to do. I mean, I think, and looking at prints as well. You know, I mean, comparing one study of a Rembrandt etching to another, you know, that's where connoisseurship is made. You know, if you care about such things, and I still care about it deeply, but I really cared about it. I really cared about it then. Oh, Douglas, we ought to have him come down and visit us sometime. So, because I spent all this time with these works of art, like I said, the first 2 years I did nothing but schlep these drawings. And so, I mean, that's 2 years of just looking at drawings and looking at prints, you know, and I wound up doing other stuff as well. But I developed a real affection for these works on paper and for the study of works on paper. I mean, it's just, you know, it's just an interesting, quirky, unusual discipline all its own. And when you're looking at drawings like this, and most of the drawings that you're going to see are from the collection of the Art Institute of Chicago, and they're all, I made up my mind that I would not show, apart from this kind of opening thing with the Vitruvian Man, from now on, I've seen every one of these drawings multiple times and looked at them very carefully. And I'm starting with this Rembrandt drawing. It's about, you know, it's maybe about this thing. But this Rembrandt, for crying out loud, I mean, it couldn't be. This isn't a studio of Rembrandt. This is a follower of Rembrandt. This isn't Rembrandt and his students. This is Rembrandt himself, you know, looking at it, a seated nude, and recording her, making that drawing. I mean, these marks belong to Rembrandt. This is the hand of this artist. I mean, I was always thinking, look at that line. I mean, it makes no sense in the, you know, and he knew that, but it's somehow impossible to imagine that line without that sharp, straight, unnatural line. Same thing over here. You know, I mean, he's probably, this is just kind of what drawing teachers call the action marks. That line looks like it's sitting, I mean, it is sitting on top, but it probably started here before you ever saw any of this shading in back behind or the curve of the steel. Same thing back here. He's bang, bang, bang. And then he does the most amazing thing. I mean, there's actually a kind of sweet sensitivity in this drawing. I mean, he's a 17th century man looking at Dutch man, looking at a 17th century Dutch woman who's not wearing any clothing. Now, you know, it was a, you know, I mean, this was a perfectly legitimate thing to be doing, but look at how she's looking down. And more than that, look at how brilliantly he's foreshortened that face, you know? I mean, it's just kind of amazing. And to think that this is him, and I've carried this drawing in my hands dozens of times. And then, you know, this was, I mean, and again, I'm not a scholar of Baroque art or of what came after, but somehow hauling out this Watteau of these Commedia dell'arte figures, it just absolutely resonated with me. And this figure, especially this big, one of his most famous paintings is a painting of a harlequin. And this painting, I don't know if it was any time near when he paints his harlequin painting, but it's just a marvelous thing, and it's a study. This is him trying to figure things out. And that was disappointing, but I just did. was told I was going to like this play. Yeah, I think I may have pushed two buttons at the same time. And my excitement about the fold in the pants of this guy right here. I mean, look at how he's actions his way, actions his way down. It's a brilliant thing. And Watteau tended to work in red chalk. So you're looking at the other. Well, this isn't a particularly good example. I'll show you. And then this incredible pastel by Chardin. You know, this a self-portrait. I love that he's wearing this visor and this pince-nez. And I mean, it's kind of a formal portrait. And I almost didn't put it in because, you know, pastel is, to me, I mean, pastels are drawing. I mean, you definitely have a stick of something and you're rubbing it on paper. But to me, pastels are almost a little more like paintings than they are like drawings. But this is such a beautiful thing. People came to see it, requested it all the time. And then this drawing was just a marvel to me. If you ever get a chance, I mean, put this one on your list. The Art Institute didn't have the best drawings by pattern, but we had pretty good ones. What you really want, I mean, and you know, these kind of portrait drawings that Albert made are incredibly beautiful. And I mean, you're looking at, I mean, this is one man, one pencil, one sheet of paper. I mean, we could give everyone in this room, no matter how talented you are, those same tools and all the time in the world, and you would never come up with this. And, you know, the thing you probably can't, you may not even be able to see it. He makes this in Rome in around 1810. Here's St. Peter's. There's a fully elaborated portrait of St. Peter's Basilica. You know, down at the lower left in the background. I mean, just the precision is incredible. And I mean, Edward believed in a line. You know, he believed in the power of drawing. I mean, it was. He said, if you're representing smoke, there needs to be lines in it. And you know, he was so. Committed to this idea that it's all that he became famous. I mean, he was already a famous artist. I mean, here's Agatha over here, and he's jousting with his great rival Delacroix, who's obviously holding a paintbrush, and it's all about viva la color, and he's viva la line, and he's holding a stylus. This was people knew about this, and this is a cartoon by Bertrand that was in the popular press. And then this is just a sensational drawing. This is a drawing by Courbet. And the thing, I think I've got it. I mean, this is a drawing that I hauled out for people many, many times and pulled out just to look at it myself because it's so beautiful. I mean, here we're back to where we were with Rembrandt. You know, we're in the studio. You know, and this is a model. You know. Taking that, you know, sitting on a little riser here, and she's kicked off one of her shoes, probably because her feet are starting to ache, and she's resting her arm on his, so she can hold this pose for a while, but you know, and also just to alleviate the boredom, she's holding this book and she's probably actually reading it, and she needs all that because what may have started is just a sketch. You know, I mean, you know, and this is what happens sometimes. I mean, this almost certainly started as just, you know, a preparatory study for something that Courbet is planning to do later on. But sometimes it just begins to work out. You know, it just begins to be a successful thing in its own right. And so he keeps working and keeps working and keeps working. And this is a fully resolved drawing. But I bet anything, I'm guessing anyway, this is the conclusion I came to from all the years of looking at this thing, that it couldn't possibly have started that way. You know, it's just, you know, you just never know when an artist is going to get really interested in something. And I think that's what happened. that's what happened in this drawing. It's a beautiful thing. We'll get to something. This is another one that that I pulled out for myself many, many times, but it also came out for others. This is early Degas. This is Degas when he's in, he's not Degas in Paris. I mean, at this point, he's Degas in Rome. And this particular guy is a fairly well-known model in Rome at the time. He turns up in drawings by any number of people, but they're never more beautiful. It's never more beautiful than in this drawing by Degas. Now, look, here's what I wanted to point out, and we'll talk about this more. While I was at the Art Institute, within the Department of Prints and Drawings was a sort of a subset. I mean, there were curators, research assistants, the Douglas, the department head, there were specialists in Italian drawings, in English drawings, in contemporary drawings, and Douglas was the specialist in 19th century French things. But there was also a paper conservation lab within that department, and there were three conservators who worked in that lab, every day. And in some cases, and then there were two preparators who would put things in maps and make sure they were presented safely. And these conservators, sometimes they would be doing restorations on prints and drawings in the collection, but more often than not, they were doing original research of their own, studying the technical processes that go into making any given drawing. And so here, we get the media description for this particular Degas drawing is charcoal with stumping, heightened with touches of black chalk on ivory wove paper. I mean, we developed a whole language of description about these drawings, and we'll start paying attention to this moving forward. Because it's kind of interesting, and two, I'm going to show you some of the variations. Now, who knows what stumping is? You know what? Tell us what stumping is.
Well, I know what stumping is.
Yeah.
It's a little short stick made of felt or paper.
Compressed paper, often.
Compressed
paper that you use to shade, kind of manipulate. You can remove material with it. You can blur material with it, charcoal with it. It's just a way of manipulating the surface like this. This light place in this man's forehead was probably reflects some erasure. Although we've got touches of white chalk, so it could be that as well. But the touches of white chalk may also be creating the highlights here. And as I recall, they ran down into the shirt as well. But this would have been all been. See this kind of pattern in the charcoal? That can be done with the same thing on the side of his face. That can be done very easily with stumping, with an estompe, as the French call it. And then this fabulous thing. We had very, very beautiful Degas pastels, and I would have showed them to you, but it would have just made you cry. And there were like paintings and drawings anyway. But this one, I always loved this drawing, and it kind of reminds me, and it really occurred to me until I was pulling things together for this lunch and learn. It reminds me very much of the Three Shades out in Garrett Court, where you're seeing essentially the same model, the same pose, she just turned. And it's almost as if Degas is capturing her, capturing her spinning, or he's moving around her. I mean, it's just kind of a brilliant thing. And like our Degas pastel and charcoal drawing, which we love so much that he may have spent 15 minutes making, it's probably the same thing here. Degas made thousands of drawings just like this, which is not to say they aren't beautiful, but look at this. this. This is charcoal and pastel with stumping and touches of brush and black wash on grayish hand-laid paper with blue fibers. I mean, are we getting into some detail here? You know, it's, chances are this sheet of paper was originally blue. The French love blue paper, they call it bluté. But it was very, the pigments that went into that paper were very fugitive and they tended to fade over time. We had an Odeon Red on pastel that was of Ophelia, and it had been drawn on bluté, on this wonderful, wonderful, beautiful blue paper. But the blue had faded entirely. It was like Ophelia was drowning in sand. You know, so anyway, these things, and so, you know, you describe what you're seeing in a media description, but you also allude to what may have been, and that's where we're seeing the evidence. It's now a grayish hand-laid paper with blue fibers suggests that it probably was on a sheet of blue paper originally. And then this is just like fabulous. And it's a Pontet Latour portrait of Edward Manet, and you know, the artist did also own the painting. That it was either before or after. What I've never been able to figure out was whether this drawing a study for the painting? I don't think anybody really knows. We know that Fontaine kept it for a long time. He eventually gives it to Mon Ami, my friend Manet, Fontaine. Manet's stepson slash maybe half brother, after Manet dies, gives it to Aristide Albert. But it likely is a study, or it could easily be a study, but it could also be a drawing after the fact, because drawings were also one of the better means in the 19th century of actually recording a painting. I mean, photography just didn't do it nearly as well. These are just a fantastic pair of both in the collection of the Art Institute. And look what a dandy he is. Mm-hmm. It's a fantastic thing.
This is life-size.
What now? Yeah, it's pretty close to life-size. I mean, it's probably, that painting is not quite as big as you're seeing it on the screen. You know, it's still easel painting size. The drawing is big too. I mean, the drawing is, you know, like something like that. It's considerable. And now we get to my buddy, Odeon Redon. And this is a drawing that's in the Contemplating Character show, and I've been sort of, I don't know, mooning over it for about a week. And this is a drawing by Claude Emile Schuffenegger of Redon, and I think it was made. Schuffenegger was a great friend of, you know, a great friend of a lot of artists. He was an artist himself, he was also a writer, and I believe that this drawing was made to be reproduced in an article that Schuffenegger wrote about Odeon Redon, you know, sometime in the early 1890s. And you know, I mean, look at him. You know, he's a perfectly delightful little Parisian bourgeois. You know, and I know quite a little bit about Odeon Redon because along with Douglas Druid. I was part of a team of international scholars that did the Odeon Redon retrospective in 1994. That show opened at the Art Institute of Chicago and then traveled to the Van Gogh Museum in Amsterdam and closed at the Royal Academy of Arts in London. And it was a major project, a major reclamation project. People had kind of forgotten who Redon was, but the Art Institute had these incredibly important holdings of the artist's work, and he's an almost exact contemporary of the Impressionist generation. He's born the same year as Monet, same year as Renoir, but he's anything but. You know, he thought that the Impressionist generation were somewhat what he called low of ceiling, meaning they lacked imagination, whereas Impressionism was kind of all about observation. You know, Redon's work was all about his imagination at his heart, and really his intellect as well. And so he made these strange charcoal drawings. And all of these drawings none of these are studies for something else. These are all drawings that are completed works of art in their own right. And this is a drawing we bought when I was there. It's called L'Homme Primitif, the primitive man. And it's made up of various charcoals with touches of black chalk stumping, wiping and erasing, heightened with touches of whitening over wash on green wove paper, altered to pale golden tone. And we were just that obsessive about every single thing in the collection. I mean, you know, it's no artist has had their technical process of art making more carefully examined than Odeon Redon. And his work was, his work was moving. People thought he was an opium smoker. You know, they thought he was just this crazed man who's producing these large, these nightmarish drawings, of hybrid creatures that absolutely made no sense. But in fact, like I said, he was a little bourgeois, lived in an apartment, raised his family. I mean, he was as normal. He was as far from being avant-garde as anybody you'd ever want to meet. But he made these fantastic things. This is a beautiful. When we bought this as well. When I was there, we actually bought it from Wolfgang Fittrar. And when we bought it, it had the title "Dawn of the Last Day." You know, and all of Redon's work had kind of absorbed these dramatic and almost depressing titles in a way. And one of the things that we were able to do in our work on Redon was we eventually got a hold of his stock book, the list of the book that this unpublished thing that listed, that where Redon himself listed every work of art he ever made, the year he made it, and who he sold it to. It's a thing in the French called the Livre de Raison. And we had it, and it was, it wasn't Redon's. Redon's is in the collection, is in the Anyway, I thought it was. I was sure it was. It's kind of a catchy tune. We didn't have Redon's actual Livre de Raison. We had one of his friends, a man named Andre Malaria, who was a collector of Redon's work and his first biographer and the cataloger of his lithographs, actually borrowed the Livre de Raison and all of his other personal papers as well, and made a handwritten copy of everything. He was like a human copy machine. I mean, the devotion this takes to your process. No wonder we're cataloging the technical process of making these things within an inch of its life. Malaria had set the example. And so we had Malario's copy and bought it from this kind of scumbag dealer in Paris for a lot of money, but it was totally, totally, totally worth it because Redon's copy, his actual copy, had been placed by his children in the Bibliothèque du Sey, and it was due to be it couldn't be unsealed for another 20 years after we were doing our project. And so to have this thing was like power itself. It wasn't as good as, you know, hanging out with Harrison Ford, but it was close. one of my jobs was to transcribe it all. So it wasn't enough that we had this paper copy, this handwritten copy of all of these notes with all of this information. You know, it had to all be transcribed. I probably spent a year doing that, but it paid off. It made things searchable a little bit. Plus, you know, my memory was much better at that point, and so, you know, I held so much of the stuff in my head, just like the act of carrying these drawings, you know, from the vault to the study room. you know, I was able to absorb a fair amount of information about these particular works of art. The very act of transcribing all this stuff, you can't help but kind of learn it. And so what we found was that